Hello, everyone, and welcome to Internet Law Review. For today's story, we have the case of BL versus Mahanoy Area School District. This is a trial court decision from the Middle District of Pennsylvania, a federal court. And as this court says, this raises questions of whether a public school can lawfully remove a student from extracurricular activity for her profanity transmitted off school grounds on a Saturday to fellow students. Plaintiff BL, a student at Mahanoy Area High School, was dismissed from the cheerleading squad for uttering "fuck school, fuck softball, fuck cheer, fuck everything" off school grounds on Saturday. Well, I'm already intrigued. This appears to be the most interesting case dealing with free speech issues as it relates to people in K-12 that's below age 18 in K-12 schools in the United States. And it's the most interesting case relating to free speech off campus since the U.S. Supreme Court case of Morris v. Frederick in 2007, which ruled on the legality of a high school principal punishing a student for unfurling a banner that said "Bong hits for Jesus" at an off-campus event. However, the case law that deals with freedom of speech issues as it relates to K-12 under 18 students is somewhat mixed. The most famous case in this area is the 1969 case of Tinker versus Des Moines, in which three public school students were suspended from school for wearing black armbands in protest of the Vietnam War. In this case, the U.S. Supreme Court held that wearing a black armband to protest the Vietnam War was protected speech because doing so did not unduly disrupt the academic purpose of the school environment. So the case law, as it involves school officials in K-12 under 18 environments to punish students for either on-campus speech or off-campus speech, is mixed, as we saw from these twin cases. So let's see how those two cases might apply to the current factual situation and see on which side of the line this case should be drawn. In her freshman year, BL joined the junior varsity cheerleading squad led by coaches Nicole Lucetta Rump and April Nall. Freshman year in the United States is typically 15 years of age. The squad held tryouts for the next school year in May of BL's freshman year. Before she could try out, however, BL was required to agree to a number of rules that would apply to her if she made the squad again. These rules, the cheerleading rules, or rules stated, "Please have respect for your schools, coaches, teachers, other cheerleaders, and teams. Remember, you are representing your school when at games, fundraisers, and other events. Good sportsmanship will be enforced. This includes foul language and inappropriate gestures." BL and her mother reviewed the rules prior to tryouts and signed a document acknowledging BL would be bound by them. Unfortunately for BL, tryouts did not go so well. She was placed on the junior varsity squad again for her sophomore year, that would typically be 16, and to add insult to injury, an incoming freshman made varsity squad. So by way of factual background, in high school sports, it's typical for many schools to have two sets of teams, the varsity team, which is the main team, and a junior team, which is the subordinate team, and it's usually related to experience. So it is a little unusual for an incoming freshman, this would be their first year of high school, to be put on the varsity team, especially in light of a sophomore who was trying to apply, but that's the way it went in this case. Let's read on. Posing in street clothes with a friend, middle fingers raised, BL took a selfie at the Cocoa Hut, a local store and student stomping ground. On top of the photo, BL added the following text: "Fuck school, fuck softball, fuck cheer, fuck everything." BL then posted the captioned photo, the snap, on her private Snapchat account, where it could have been viewed briefly by about 250 of her friends. She posted a follow-up snap just after reading, "Love how me and my friend got told we need a year of JV before we made varsity, but that doesn't matter to anyone else." One of those cheerleaders, Coach Nall's daughter, came across the snaps, took the screenshots of them as they were not publicly viewable, and brought them to the coach's attention. So the coach's daughter is a narc. Outstanding! Meanwhile, with the weekend now over, word of BL snaps spread throughout the school. Several students, both cheerleaders and non-cheerleaders, approached Coach Loretta Rump to express their concerns that snaps were inappropriate. Students were visibly upset and voiced their concerns to Coach Loretta Rump repeatedly for several days. Even though electronic squabbling among cheerleaders at high school is a fairly typical occurrence, I would think, the schools felt the need to enforce the rules against BL to avoid chaos and maintain a team-like environment. The cheerleading coaches would not have suspended BL from the team had her snaps not referenced cheerleading. BL's father appealed to the school board, but the board declined to get involved. Accordingly, BL, through her parents, filed suit against the district for declaratory and injunctive relief. On a personal level, I just simply love it when cases like this make it to a federal court. You know, you always hear that saying, hey, do you want to make a federal case out of this? And apparently in this case, the answer was yes, yes, I do. The court, in discussing the law, says the Supreme Court established in the landmark case of Tinker v. Des Moines that public school students do not shed their speech rights at the schoolhouse gates. So as I said before, this is a case dealing with wearing black armbands during the Vietnam War, and it's probably the foundational case dealing with free speech issues as it relates to K through 12 schools. The first exception was created in Bethel School District v. Frazier, 1986, also a very famous case. In Frazier, a student gave a speech laden with sexual innuendo at a school assembly. The school suspended the student, and the Supreme Court upheld the suspension on the ground a student may punish students for offensively lewd, obscene, indecent, and vulgar speech without finding that a substantial disruption would have occurred. In Collamer, the court held that schools may exercise editorial control over the style and content of student speech in a school-sponsored expressive activity so long as its actors are reasonably related to legitimate pedagogical concerns, which is legitimate teaching concerns. Under the Collamer exception, schools are entitled to exercise greater control over school-sponsored expressive activities that students, parents, and members of the public might reasonably believe to bear the imprimatur of the school. The final exception to Tinker was announced in Morris v. Frederick, the famous Bong Hits for Jesus case, in which a student held up a banner saying exactly that at an off-school activity event. So with these four major cases in mind, what is the derived lesson? Well, according to the trial court, under the Supreme Court student speech precedents, there are four rules. Under Frazier, a school may categorically prohibit lewd, vulgar, or profane language. Under Collamer, a school may regulate school-sponsored speech on the basis of any legitimate pedagogical, any legitimate educational concern. Under Morse, a school may categorically prohibit speech that can be reasonably regarded as encouraging illegal drug use. And speech falling outside these categories is subject to Tinker's general rule. It may be regulated only if it would substantially disrupt school operations or interfere with the rights of others. In even more generalized principle, these cases of First Amendment law deal with what's sometimes called time, place, manner restrictions. Under the U.S. Supreme Court's various free speech guidelines, there are different levels of scrutiny that are applied to different kinds of restriction. For example, if you want to restrict the substance of what someone says, that's decided under the highest level of scrutiny called strict scrutiny. But if you want to put what's called time, place, manner restrictions, in other words, you want to set certain times, certain places, certain methods, that can be held under a lower standard. And the rationale for this lower standard should be fairly obvious. You know, without the ability to set time, place, manner restrictions, the government would not be able to pass a law that said, for example, your neighbor cannot play blisteringly loud music at 3 a.m. in the morning when it's right next to your house. You know, that there are things that we all have the right to enjoy, our own quiet, our own peace, and the ability of the government to regulate time, place, and manner restrictions is dedicated to this. You can't use First Amendment rights to fundamentally disrupt other operations that are going on. Now, of course, these restrictions can be written too tightly, and in which case the courts will give them further review. But the idea, as long as there's ample time, ample opportunity, ample methodology, that the courts will look at it under a lower basis of review, traditionally intermediate scrutiny. The court continues, I need to clear away some argumentative brush before getting to the root of the dispute. The district, that is the school district, first argues that BL waived her First Amendment rights when she joined the cheerleading squad. The district maintains that both BL and her mother voluntarily waived BL's First Amendment rights by signing the application for cheerleading tryouts. BL responds there's no evidence supporting a finding of a waiver, and regardless, the district, the school district, cannot condition extracurricular participation on waiver of constitutional rights. The court continues, additionally, conditioning extracurricular participation on a waiver of constitutional rights is coercive. The court says, finally, the school district argues that because students have no constitutional right to participate in extracurricular activities like cheerleading, fair enough, BL's mere removal from the squad could not have violated her rights. In response, BL argues that whether or not she has a constitutional right to participate in extracurricular activities, whether a coach's sanction was harsh enough, is irrelevant to the First Amendment analysis. The court continues, the threshold inquiry under standard First Amendment analysis is whether the speech is protected, considering the speech at issue and the context in which it was uttered. Student speech that would not materially disrupt school or invade the rights of others is protected. That standard does not ask courts to consider the punishment the school dealt out or its effect on independent constitutional interests in determining whether school speech was protected in the first place. The court finishes by saying, all this discussion can be distilled into a single point. Coaches cannot punish students for what they say off the field if that speech fails to satisfy the tests from Tinker or Collamer standards. Even then, whether Tinker applies the speech uttered beyond the schoolhouse gate is an open question. The trial court says, I need not weigh in on that question, however. The undisputed evidence shows that neither of these standards have been met, so BL's speech was protected. Accordingly, the district violated BL's rights when Coach Loretta Rump dismissed her from the cheerleading squad. The overriding principle is that schools must be able to fulfill their fundamental mission of education. But that being said, students, even ones K through 12, have First Amendment rights and other rights guaranteed by the Constitution. And those rights must extend as far as they can, as long as the educational mission is not unduly hampered. Because this speech occurred off campus, because the student was not in their uniform, and because it does not relate to anything that could be understood as a waiver, the court here says that BL must be readmitted to the cheerleading squad. So a victory for BL, and I suppose she'll be shaking her pom-poms with just a little bit extra sass, knowing that she beat the system. For now, my friends, this is all. I hope this has been helpful. Until later, cheers and goodbye.